What is your favorite Winston play in all of Overwatch's history? Got it? Good. Is it a perfectly timed primal rage that sends multiple foes careening off of the map? Is it a clutch bubble that saves friends from certain death? Is it the incredible acrobatics that Winston players display while they leap all over the map and gain multiple kills while doing so? In any case, the way that Winston is played at the highest level today was revolutionized by one man. Everything you know and love about Winston players can be traced back to him. At one point, he was the greatest main tank in the world, and then he wasn't. His name is Gong Jin-hyuk, but you may know him as Miro. This is his story. Miro was born on February 26, 1996, somewhere in South Korea. Frankly, there isn't much to be found on the internet about his early life, not in English anyways, and I think that adds to the story of Miro. The fact that going into 2016, his 20th birthday, no one really knew who he was. That's a stark contrast to now, where some of our most exciting prospects aren't even legal adults, but I digress. Of course, it can be assumed that one thing led to another, and Miro ended up getting into this new FPS called Overwatch. In South Korea, esports has a much bigger foothold into culture than in the West. In fact, many have likened the way esports stars are treated in South Korea to the way boy bands are treated in the US. So with a brand new game that seemed destined for esports on the horizon, many saw a chance to make it to the top without having to climb a mountain to get there. One of those people, again it's assumed, was Miro, who decided to specialize in the main tank role, which in early Overwatch meant you would pretty much be playing Reinhardt all the time. Miro, however, would change that, as you'll soon see. At the beginning of his career, Miro satisfied himself with playing smaller tournaments as the Overwatch scene was still developing, but as a stroke of luck, Miro would end up meeting the person who would change his life forever. While playing in an online tournament hosted by Afrika TV, a Korean streaming service and title sponsor to Afrika Freaks, he ended up playing alongside Eska, who happened to be involved in an esports organization called Lunatic High, who specialized in first-person shooters and was looking to create an Overwatch team. Eska was apparently so impressed by Miro's main tank play that he personally went to the staff of Lunatic High and recommended him for the team. This random encounter is what set Miro off on a collision course to become an Overwatch legend. The team started out doing quite well, with second place finishes in the Overwatch Power League and APAC Premier 2016, but it is worth mentioning that in the latter event, Lunatic High hadn't lost a single match until the finals, including two victories over the eventual champions, Rogue. Miro impressed enough in the Korean scene to be chosen to represent Korea for the first ever Overwatch World Cup, in what would prove to be a pivotal event in Miro's career.
When you play against him, it's very frustrating because he's so good at timing his engages and getting out that it's very, very hard to actually kill him.
Now, until this tournament, the Western audience hadn't yet become acquainted with Miro or Lunatic High, half of South Korea's team. In fact, if you were to believe what people were saying, the top teams in the Overwatch World Cup were Sweden and Finland, who each had many future legends in the best of their time in their own right, like Chips Hyun, Coco, Tevik, Zappis, Taimu, and Linkser, who, as a side note, played Reinhardt at the time? 2016 was weird. But South Korea was determined to cement the esports capital of the world as the leaders in Overwatch. South Korea didn't lose a map throughout the entire event, including the playoffs, and a large chunk of credit went to Miro, because he simply played Winston different than anyone else. Remember, this is season 2 or 3 of competitive play, and most teams favored Reinhardt-anchored compositions, but Miro changed everything in this event. Here. In this clip, watch the way Miro expertly weaves in and out of Australia's push, the way he times his primal rage, and the way he perfectly distances every jump.
Oh, that's the thing, he just knows his limits so well. As we see him go in after Kura there, Miro just, like you said, knows when to go out, and he doesn't really need to worry about that right now. Pops a primal rage just to finish off Yuki, knows the damage ranges as well on that character so well, and Australia just having no chance here, getting on the point. Miro going deep here in this defense, but yep. Time to go back. A little bit of damage to Lucio on the way out, maybe. Or just kill him. You could just kill him.
This event could very well have been the birth of the Winston playstyle we know and love today. What did IDDQD say when asked what the key was to defeating South Korea in the semifinals?
They're super coordinated. It all comes down to shutting down Miro.
Unfortunately for them, no one was able to take the pressure that Miro was constantly putting on their team's backlines. Even if they did manage to kill him, which was rare, he had given the rest of his team enough space for the teammates Arhan and Eska to shine. After the South Korean victory, Miro was chosen as the MVP of the entire event, a nice little bow on top of all he had accomplished at BlizzCon 2016. Let's not forget that Miro was no slouch on Reinhardt either, but his Winston play is what cemented him as one of the, no, the best main tank player in the world. After his dominance in the World Cup, Miro returned to South Korea to continue competing for Lunatic High. In Apex Season 1, Lunatic High was upset by Kongdu Unxia in the first round of the playoffs, led by this new rising star called Birdring. However, just making the playoffs was enough for Lunatic High to be invited back for Season 2, where they just exploded onto the scene. After easily advancing through the first round of group stages, Lunatic High got their revenge on Kongdu Unxia in the second round of group stages in order to advance to the playoffs past them. They would then pull off a 5-map victory over Meta Athena and a 7-map victory over Runaway to take the Apex Trophy for Season 2. Then, in Season 3, they did it all again, defeating Birdring again in the finals as they took a 7-map win over Kongdu Panthera. Throughout this success, the narrative was clear. Lunatic High had underperforming DPS. The only reason they did so well was because Miro was able to buy so much time and space for them to work with. And Jaehong was there too, but this video isn't about him. So Apex Season 4 rolls around, and this time Lunatic High is knocked out during the second round of group stages. But that's okay, because there's this new thing called the Overwatch League starting up soon, and it's the future of Overwatch esports, and Lunatic High must be preparing for the move. That's all it is, right? And lo and behold, the first six players that were announced to have joined the unnamed team representing Seoul were, of course, all from Lunatic High. There were some additions made, some goodbyes were said, and the new Seoul Dynasty were ready to take over the inaugural season of the Overwatch League. Well, that's not exactly what happened. I already made a video talking in depth about the Seoul Dynasty's performance in Season 1, so I'll throw an iCard up now and you can watch it if you haven't already. However, the main takeaway from that video is that Miro went from a strong main tank to average to struggling so hard that he ended up getting benched for backup Kuki near the end of the season. Main tank, for once, was one of the weakest parts of the Lunatic High roster. They even had Jaehong play main tank, which went about as well as you would expect. In the end, the Seoul Dynasty that many expected to win the entire league ended up in just 8th place, and Miro, who I must remind you was the best main tank in the world just a few years ago, is currently looking for a new team to call home. So, what just happened? How did Miro fall so far? While I'm not involved with the Seoul Dynasty and I can't tell you what's going on behind the scenes, I do have a few guesses. Firstly, I feel like Miro struggled under the Seoul Dynasty coaching staff, though everyone did, so that's no surprise. Of course, the Seoul Dynasty ended up with all new DPS players instead of Eska and Who Are You, whom they had been playing with for months or years. Not only that, but the coaches seemed satisfied to switch players in and out constantly, making it impossible for a core 6-player squad to synergize and establish a style of play. Secondly, it's important to remember that since Miro was head and shoulders above every other Winston player in the world, every move he made in the game was watched and documented by people who wanted to become as great as him. Now, when Miro got into Overwatch, the game was so young that there wasn't much time to really learn how to play a hero like Winston. He was so good, based mostly off of his instinct. However, once people began figuring out how to emulate his style and then eventually improve upon it, Miro found himself falling behind. Being able to shift and adjust your playstyle due to circumstances and who you're playing is much easier when you've learned the game. It's much harder to change instinct. Finally, the game itself is changing and evolving, and this aggressive weaving in and out style of Winston isn't as effective anymore, mainly due to a tiny little Swedish problem named Brigitte. Hard to jump on an enemy team when she can rocket flow you off your path, stun you when you land, and give your target armor to make your Tesla cannon just about useless. Because of a combination of these factors and probably more, Miro couldn't play the way he wanted to play anymore, which is probably what drove him out of professional Overwatch. So, does Miro have a chance to continue playing in the future? Absolutely. I could see him getting picked up by an expansion team due to his experience, if nothing else. However, even if he does end up on the stage, it's likely that Miro's days of harassing enemy backlines without any competition are over. But I sure wouldn't be complaining if he found a sudden resurgence. However, before you laugh at Miro due to his Overwatch League Stage 1 performances and call him a trash main tank, think about your favorite Winston play and remember, that player was more likely than not influenced by the best main tank in the world, the one who wrote the fundamentals of Winston, the prototypical main tank, Miro. Thank you guys so much for watching the first ever player interview? I don't know. I made this video because I think Miro's story is fascinating. People are way too quick to judge him because of the Overwatch League without knowing all that he's done to shape the game that we know and love today, especially on Winston. And I wanted to get that story out to the world the best way that I could, so I hope I did it justice. If you enjoyed the story as much as I enjoyed telling it, make sure to leave a like on the video and subscribe if you haven't yet. We are inching closer and closer to 10k, and I am so excited, but I digress. Thank you all so much for watching, and until next time, don't get tilted. Peace, nut.